Hello everyone, welcome to today's webinar. My name is Anne Cumming, and for those who are joining for the first time, I'm the Principal Advisor for Cognitive Impairment at the Australian Commission on Safety and Quality in Healthcare. So today's webinar is about safer use of medicines for cognitive impairment. It is our seventh webinar for the Caring for Cognitive Impairment campaign. So today we're going to provide you with key elements for the medication safety for people with cognitive impairment. And by having a panel, we're going to illustrate the importance of the team approach, providing a consumer, pharmacy, medicine, and nursing perspective. So what you can do is type questions or comments in your control panel as we go along. We're going to run a quick poll at the beginning just to get an idea of who's on the webinar today. And we're also going to ask you to think about and reflect on the case study that will be presented during the session. And we'll give you the opportunity to write what you think went well and what didn't. And also during the session, do feel free to post questions, and we'll come to that at the end of our discussion. First of all, we're going to ask you a poll. What's your position? So far, we've got the majority of people being health professionals in hospital. We have some health service managers. We have a few consumers, some people from primary health and community, and also some others. So thank you for that. The webinar is part of the Commission's Caring for Cognitive Impairment campaign, and our campaign is to increase awareness of cognitive impairment as an important safety and quality issue for all Australian hospitals. It's also, we're having the campaign to help prepare health service organisations for the introduction of the new standards, which will be mandatory for all public and private hospitals and day surgeries and some dental services. And now, of course, there are cognitive impairment items in the comprehensive care standard, which is a new standard in the standards. And also there is being alert to delirium is included in recognizing and responding to acute deterioration. Now, the appropriate use of medicines is a crucial component to safe and high quality care for people with cognitive impairment. And we know that inappropriate use of medicines can have a major impact on a person's outcome, can hinder recovery and cause harm. So the medication safety provides important concepts that we'll draw on today. The standard aims to ensure that clinicians safely prescribe, dispense and administer appropriate medicines, and also to ensure consumers understand their own medicine needs and risks. Consumers should always be in the focus, a central focus, and we can partner with them, making sure we provide information that can be understood and used, and we also share decisions so that we can improve the safety and quality of healthcare. So I now have great pleasure in introducing our panel to us. First of all, we have Mary Etty Leal, who's a pharmacist, Deputy Director of Pharmacy at Royal Melbourne Hospital. Mary also provides valuable advice for us in our Cognitive Impairment Advisory Group. We also have Dr. Anne-Marie Rudden, who's a geriatrician and associate professor, staff specialist in general medicine and geriatrics at Gold Coast University Hospital. And she's been involved in an important Queensland healthcare improvement project aimed at auditing medication use for older people in public hospitals. And it's also implementing geriatric evaluation management, or GEM, in the home so that people can avoid a hospital admission when that's appropriate. We also have Anne Mohead, a nurse practitioner in psychogeriatrics and dementia in northern New South Wales, based at Lismore Hospital. And she's been leading the implementation of the Confused Hospitalised Older Persons Program in that hospital, and also has provided advice for us through the Commission's Technical Working Group for the Delirium Clinical Care Standard. So what we're going to do is we're going to go over to Mary, who's going to introduce a consumer story for us.
Okay, thanks, Anne. So I'm going to present today a case of Mrs. Joy Taylor, and this is a constructed case by myself and Anne-Marie and Anne, and it's based on our experiences working in hospital. So I hope that you can relate to elements of this case as we go through. So who is Joy? Well, Joy is an 80-year-old woman who lives at home with her husband. She has three supportive daughters who live nearby. In the home, she's mostly independent with her personal tasks, but she does need some assistance with shopping and banking and running errands. To assist her with her medicines, she uses a Webster pack. And Joy lives with Parkinson's disease, some form of cognitive impairment that hasn't been formally diagnosed, reflux, heart troubles, diabetes, and difficulty sleeping. So one evening, Joy rushes to the toilet and unfortunately falls, hurt her hips, and was rushed to hospital in an ambulance. Once she reached the hospital, unfortunately she was diagnosed with a fractured hip. She had surgery and was transferred to the surgical ward with her regular medicines charted based on the Webster pack that Mr. Taylor remembered to bring into hospital in the rush, along with some pain relief and medicines to prevent blood clots. So the next day on the surgical ward, the nurse was dressing Joy, and she found that there was a patch on Joy's skin that wasn't prescribed. She made a referral to the pharmacist, who conducted a medication history. And that pharmacist determined that not only was she on medicines in the Webster pack, which included levodopa, pantoprazole, some aspirin, atorvastatin, metformin, and metoprolol, she also found that she was on a glycerol trinitrate patch for her heart that wasn't in the pack, and temazepam that she uses every night to help her get to sleep. Additionally, she also likes to take some fish oil each day to help her with aches and pains. So the pharmacist alerted the team to the fact that she was on these additional medicines and queried whether these additional medicines could have contributed to her falls. Later that evening, Joy became agitated. She was calling out, trying to get out of her bed, and started refusing some of her medications. Nurses, distressed by her behaviours and anxious to get medicines into Joy, contacted the cover doctor to come and review. Over the next days and nights, various treating surgeons and covering doctors prescribed a variety of medicines to control the agitation. So this included, for example, some stat haloperidol, which started off as an oral dose, but when that didn't work, they prescribed another IM dose of haloperidol. And they also prescribed some olanzapine of 5 milligrams 4 times a day when necessary. They also made several changes to her analgesics to try and control her pain. After several days, the ongoing agitation was reviewed by the geriatric team, who advised that they reduce the analgesics and the antipsychotics, suggested permanently ceasing temazepam, as well as looking at deprescribing the atorvastatin and pantoprazole. Joy's admission progressed slowly with challenges along the way. During her moves throughout the hospital system, she had multiple medication charts written up by multiple members of the healthcare team, with some medication doses being missed due to ward moves. Of particular importance, she missed quite a few doses of her levodopa through these moves. She unfortunately also developed an aspiration pneumonia requiring IV antibiotics and experienced a fall while trying to get out of bed one evening. After 28 days in hospital, Joy moved to the local transitional care facility with the goal of improving her reduced mobility and further resolution of her delirium. Her discharge medications included the levodopa for her Parkinson's, aspirin, metformin, denosumab for her fracture, and some vitamin D. so we can see that quite a few medicines were stopped throughout her hospital stay. A medication list, such as the one here, was provided to the family and patient on transfer to the transitional care facility to explain the changes. Family were quite surprised by the number of changes made and queried why they weren't involved in the decision making. So, Anne, would you like to take over from this section, asking what went well and what could have been done better?
Yes, that would be great. So, thank you very much, Mary, for that that story. What I'm hoping that is everyone has been thinking about what went well during that story and what could have been done better. And if you'd like to put your answers into the control panel, then I can have the opportunity to relate some of these so we can discuss them. So yes, there's some really good comments coming through. There is a query that delirium post-op was not diagnosed. There was a good review of medications. Deprescribing went well. The pharmacy went well. Received a medication chart on discharge. You know, a comment around the pharmacist undertaking the medicines reconciliation, being having Parkinson's disease and being given the wrong medication there. The nurse alerting the pharmacist to the patch on day one was also good. And we've also had the comment about the need to ask Joy and Joy's husband about the list of medications and what was not included in the Webster pack. Efforts to rationalise polypharmacy was also a thing that went well, and the other, again, the problem with not engaging with the family. So well done, participants. I think that's a really good introduction to the next part. So what we're going to do is back to Mary, who's going to explain the key elements of safer use of medicines for us, and then bring in our other two panelists. So back over to you, Mary.
Okay, excellent. So when we think about medication safety principles specific to patients with cognitive impairment in hospitals, we often tend to just think about stopping inappropriate medicines such as anticholinergics and avoiding or using antipsychotics carefully. However, there's a lot more to consider, and it aligns with the key medication safety principles in all patients. So we're going to work through these different tiles over the next half an hour or so and talk through what these mean for patients with cognitive impairment. So first one up there is medication reconciliation, which is the process of taking a medication history and aligning it with the medicines prescribed in hospital. And this is particular importance in this cohort because they might have complex medication management systems in the home, and it can be quite difficult to actually elicit what they're taking in their own home. Once we've established what they're on, we need to do a medication review to consider whether there are any medicines that have contributed to their reason for admission, or if there's any medicines that might exacerbate cognitive impairment or precipitate or cause a delirium. And then obviously the patient's in hospital for a particular reason requiring medications or requiring some form of treatment, so we need to prescribe often some new medicines. So we need to be mindful around the medicines that we select for this patient cohort. And in particular, when we're looking around picking medicines for behavioural symptoms, we've got to use them very judiciously, and we'll expand on that later on. And despite all our best attempts to come up with a beautiful medication regime, we might have reconciled the medicines, reviewed them and deprescribed and picked the right medicines, if the patient doesn't want to take them, we're going to be stuck. So medication administration is a particular interest because the patient may refuse to take the medicines, or in advanced dementia, they may have swallowing difficulties, making administration difficult. Finally, when the consumer's ready to leave the hospital, we're challenged with communicating all the changes that have happened to this patient to multiple different people, and the difficulty in patients with cognitive impairment is engaging the consumer to the right level of their understanding, plus all their carers and health professionals involved in their care. So as I mentioned, myself, Anne and Anne-Marie are going to expand on each of these key elements and share our experiences of how we can optimise medication safety in these key areas. So let's start with medication reconciliation. So as I mentioned, this is the process of taking a medication history of what the patient was taking before they came into hospital and reconciling it with the current medication charts. Taking a medication history in patients with cognitive impairment can be more challenging depending on their pre-existing medication management system in their own homes. For some, they might have been taking medicines from original packs, and if they've come in perhaps with an acute delirium, it can be very difficult to recall what medicines they were taking before they came in. Some people, such as Joy, might have had a management system such as a Webster pack, but that is often not, as our case demonstrated, all that they're taking. It also doesn't guarantee adherence. So when you're looking at a patient coming in with a dose administration aid, assessing adherence before you prescribe everything is important, so we suddenly don't overdose them. Additionally, the patients might have carers administering medicines. So due to all these complexities, it's important that we always use at least two sources to find out what the patient was taking. And often we can't know 100%, so it's doing our best to get a best possible medication history. So once we've done that, we're reviewing it against all the medication charts and looking for any discrepancies and discussing them with the treating team. And this process occurs throughout the whole hospital stay and not just on admission. So some of the key elements that, from a pharmacist's perspective, that jump to mind is that these are the types of patients that we want to prioritise for medication reconciliation. If your hospital doesn't have a full-time pharmacist or doesn't have a pharmacist that's permanently allocated to doing medication histories, these are the sorts of patients that you want to prioritise and refer for a medication review because, as mentioned, they can be a tricky cohort to get a medication history out of. Using a list of medications that the GPs provided can be helpful, but on average, GPs don't know about two of the medicines their patients take. We often have to call local pharmacies, speak to family members, engage someone to search the house for the medicines, and then we have to piece the jigsaw puzzle together. From all of that, we hopefully get our best possible medication history, but it often doesn't finish there because we may need to come back to it when the patient's cognition, for example, has improved to establish whether what we've put together was what the patient recalls taking. So in our case, we did see that we had some difficulties with getting the medication history. On admission, the admitting doctor had written the medicines up based on the Webster pack, but had missed the fact that the patient was on some additional medicines. By finding out about these additional medicines, we identified that perhaps the patch and the long-term temazepam use actually contributed to the patient's fall. So, Anne-Marie, I'd like to throw to you now to discuss what your experiences is with taking a medication history and reconciling it with a medication chart.
Thank you, Mary. I think you've done a great job outlining the major challenges to us. I think additional sources of information may be the patient's specialist. So many patients now have a GP and oftentimes a cardiologist or a neurologist. Oftentimes the patients will say certain medications but not give you the complete list. And I've found that sometimes getting in touch with multiple pharmacies is necessary as well because patients seem to buy some medications at certain pharmacies. We never can forget about the complementary and alternative medications, which seem to be popping up everywhere now as the patients purchase medicines, such as the fish oil for our patient Joy, which can have impacts on blood clotting, especially during a surgical procedure. I've always found that the prior medication administration records in the previous charts are a good place to look for some medicines that may be lost in the current list of medications. And in Queensland, we have a medication action plan paper that's often filled out by the pharmacists in Queensland Health Hospitals, and that's been a tremendous source of medication safety for our patients. The other places that I would encourage the hospital doctors to look at would be the anesthetic record. So oftentimes medications are given during the anesthetic procedure, and that would have been very key for Joy to see what medications were given then. And then there's always the missing medications, and I include the benzos or the sleeping aids, and I use alcohol as a drug when I'm evaluating patients, especially the elderly, because it can be something that they're taking regular and has tremendous impact on their balance and their liver function. So trying to get a complete medication history takes the entire team. And I guess one of my concerns is that the family is really paramount in collecting all the medications for you and bringing them in and showing them to you so that you feel as though you have a comprehensive assessment. I might ask Ann Mohead how she sees it from a nursing point of view.
Thanks, Anne-Marie, and thanks, Mary, for a great presentation. So I'd just like to reiterate my two colleagues, what you've just mentioned, and the sources, I think, are really important. I was a community nurse for many years, and one would be surprised what you find in the back cupboard of medications. So it's always good to make contact with the GP, if there are other services involved, and really be clear about the dose and the frequency. Sometimes medication might be prescribed once a day, and in fact, when you talk to the patient, the services, they might be taking that medication three times a day. So I think in that reconciliation, it's really very important to get a very clear picture of what actually is happening in the home, who's doing what, is the medication current, when was, and sometimes even ask, when was the last script filled? And that would then give you quite a good idea about the frequency. For example, for Tamaze, it may only be prescribed for 10 milligrams at night, and in fact, Joy may have been unwell, more disturbed sleep lately, and in fact, she might be taking two, or she might be taking one a week. So I think it's very important when you're collecting all your information about reconciliation that you look at all the sources. And remember, this is a cohort of people who do have cognitive impairment. So you do need to check that with the sources and the information with your carers. I guess the other thing that I think is important is to make sure there's no new medication, new antibiotics, for example, that may have just been started yesterday for maybe she fell because she's got a UTI or a chest infection. So that may not necessarily be so obvious. So check any new medications. And sometimes if the person's been in hospital recently, a recent discharge summary or a letter that's been sent to the GP may give us a new clue. So as Mary says, it's like putting the pieces together and you've got to be a bit like Sherlock Holmes to really find out what's accurate.
Excellent. So we've now, to the best of our ability, establish what the patient was taking at home. Now we need to review the medicines that the patient was taking at home and the medicines that are charted now, and have a look to see, are any of the medicines possibly contributing to the cognitive impairment? Do they have the potential to worsen cognitive impairment? Have they caused the patient's admission? And hospital admission is also another good opportunity to consider de-prescribing. And that's a process with of planned withdrawal of medicines where we don't feel that the benefits outweigh the risk at this stage. So this medicine review needs to be formalised and structured. It should be in conjunction with the patient, carer or family members, and also in collaboration with clinicians that are involved in the patient's care. There's no point trying to stop the patient's temazepam if as soon as they get home, they're just going to restart it again. So it needs to be a partnered medication review process. So Anne-Marie, what's your process for doing a medication review? What drugs are you looking for in this group of patients?
Thank you, Mary. I think first and foremost is to seek out the patients who are most vulnerable those with cognitive impairment. And I guess as a geriatrician, I can see them pretty frequently around the wards, but sometimes they can seem hidden to other people. So certainly patients who have a previous diagnosis of a cognitive problem, certainly patients with advanced age who would be at risk of having an untoward event in the hospital. And certainly orthogeriatric wards would be places to go and look for patients that, who would have formal assessment or formal protection while they're in hospital. I guess the people who help me the most is the family member who says that my mother wasn't like this before, she was never this confused. And to me, that's a really warning sign to get in there and see the patient quickly because something might be happening acutely, such as delirium, and we might be able to screen for it and try and impact on the remedial causes for it and then protect a vulnerable brain. So I think it's important to seek out these patients and have your staff tell you when someone's either come in with a pre-existing cognitive impairment, whether it's formally or informally diagnosed, and then when a family member tells you something's different. I think it's important to have a little bit of a checklist of medicines that make you nervous when you see them on older people. So the Australian Medicines Handbook is a good source to go to for medications with a high anticholinergic load, and they would include things that we use pretty actively in the elderly population, like amitriptyline and nortriptyline as two frequently used tricyclic antidepressants, and they have a high anticholinergic load. Oxybutynin or ditropan, which is used for urinary symptoms, is often prescribed for our patients, and sometimes hyoscine for secretion control. The psychoactive medications are frequently being used now. We saw in Joy that she was given haloperidol, where that would be relatively to absolutely contraindicated in someone with pre-existing Parkinson's. But a lot of patients come in with quetiapine, olanzapine, risperidone now. So seeing these medications prescribed regularly, it would be important to go and see the doses and see if perhaps the doses could be lowered. And I think therapeutic guidelines is another good source to have to look at some of these medications and which medicines are dangerous to be using and which ones we should try and deprescribe. Deprescribing can be a daunting task, but I guess there's some easy principles that all of us can apply, which is that probably every medication should have a diagnosis to go along with it, and not give the diagnosis after you find the medication. So trying to seek out, does the patient have a pre-existing reason to have the medication? Removing duplications of medications in the same class. So oftentimes patients are given a variety of ACE inhibitors, which they don't realize are the same class of medication. And then these high risk medications are a good source of medicines that could be safely weaned off and or discontinued while in hospital. I think the hospital setting allows us to have a controlled environment where we could actively liaise with each other and discuss which medications are potential ones that could be eliminated. So Anne Mohead, what do you think? How do you look at these treatment selection?
Yeah, thank you, Mary and Anne-Marie. I guess the other component that we should think about when we, and certainly supporting that whole concept of deprescribing, it is a great opportunity to do that. But I think it's important, again, that baseline assessment. So, you know, we need to ask this person or the family whether there have been any mental health problems like depression in the past. People are on long-term antidepressants, and I, in my own clinical practice, have found people have told me, you know, the doctor said I must take this tablet for the rest of my life. And then we're saying, well, you know, we're going to try and get the person off this tablet. So, again, I think it's that trying to develop good relationship with the patient, with the care and the family, trying to, as Anne-Marie says, trying to tie the medication to a disease process or a diagnosis that's happened. And and take this opportunity to de-prescribing. But I guess the other thing, we don't want to contribute to the delirium by putting this person through some sort of withdrawal, particularly if they've had long-term benzos. So it's complicated, isn't it? So I guess we're trying to give everybody a bit of an opportunity here, to a framework to hang their hat on, so that you think about all the possibilities, the complications, and as we go along, you know, trying to have the best outcome for our patient. But I think de-prescribing, always think about withdrawal, particularly in the background of benzos. We don't want to add that to the presentation of the delirium, which Joy already has. Thank you.
And touching on that, I think that there's definitely a role for the pharmacist there, due to our extensive knowledge around the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics of different medicines. We're well placed to provide advice around de-prescribing regimens, around how to slowly wean off medicines and not ceasing them abruptly. And additionally, that knowledge also allows us to advise the team around potentially inappropriate medicines, but also the combination and how using multiple medicines together might overall increase the burden. So using tools such as the anticholinergic risk scale or the drug burden index gives us an understanding of the overall impact of combination of medicines on the patient and how they may be experiencing adverse effects from that combination. So pharmacists are quite well placed to provide that sort of advice as well. So let's move through to treatment selection. So assumedly the patient's going to require some form of new medication to help manage the symptoms that brought them into hospital. And whilst the treatment choice often has similar considerations to those generally recommended for older patients, there are some extra considerations. So those principles of start low, go slow, and always consider ceasing always apply. But when we start thinking patients with cognitive impairment, some of the other additional considerations that we need to be aware of is things such as consent, which can be more troublesome in this cohort who may no longer have the ability to consent. So finding the right person that can provide that consent to start the medicines. And often, you know, as much as possible, we want to use non-pharmacological alternatives, particularly around the use of psychotropics. And as Anne mentioned at the start, we've got the second edition of these standards, which include a new comprehensive care standard that says we need to manage the use of antipsychotics and other psychoactive medicines in accordance with best practice and legislation in patients with cognitive impairment. So Anne-Marie, I'm particularly interested around your thoughts on selecting medicines for patients with cognitive impairment, particularly with respect to antipsychotics and benzodiazepines.
Thank you, Mary. I guess my main thought is that we need to diagnose delirium, and we need to actively look for it and use tools to assess delirium, because delirium indicates a very weak brain that is in jeopardy. Pleasantly confused is a euphemism we shouldn't use anymore. And of course, the quiet delirious patient is just as much at risk of having significant loss of function as a patient who has agitation. And I think, as we saw with Joy, she was doing some things that didn't make sense, which is getting out of bed with a new fractured hip, that we need to assess the patients for some of the causes for the delirium and treat those actively. So she could have been in urinary retention, she could have had more pain that wasn't being controlled, or alternatively have been, as Anne had mentioned, been withdrawing from other medications. I guess the difficulty is having the experience to understand how to assess these patients, but with our tools such as the confusion assessment method or the 4AP, we can help the doctors who are working after hours on how to evaluate patients and follow them. Oftentimes, it's the junior doctors who are on duty after hours when some of these events happen. And so I think it's really important for the more senior doctors to be involved and to review some of the pharmacological treatments that are being used for the patients, and or to ask for a consultation either through the pharmacist or through geriatricians as to what medications may be safe to use during delirium. I'm hoping that Anne Mohead will talk about the basic needs that are met, need to be met when person does have delirium as an indicator of what things have to be looked for prior to giving medication. To me, the medications are the last resort because they're associated with such difficulties as causing falls, causing pressure ulcers, and longer length of stay. So I believe if we're going to use these medications, we need to make sure the family understands why we've selected them. And if the patient can understand, to inform them as well that it's a medication that we're going to use short term to try and keep them comfortable so they don't hurt themselves. I often get asked to prescribe these medications for the other patients on the ward who are finding the noise to be upsetting. And I empathize for those patients, but I think it's difficult to give our individual patients medicines that could jeopardize their health in the long run. I think we need to have a team approach to helping these patients. The antipsychotics, if they are used, and should be at the very lowest dose and with a stop date on them. They should not have to be used long term. And we pretty much stopped using too many benzodiazepines for the treatment of delirium. I also like to think of the treatment as being a dynamic process, that it's not write the medications on the medication administration record and you're done. I think you need to come back and see the patient and lower the dose and see if you're providing any improvement for the patient's outcome. So over to you, Anne Mohead, to see how the nursing profession keeps us safe.
Thank you, Anne-Marie, and thanks, Mary, again. Look, I think that's a really strong point, is what you said, Anne-Marie. We need to make sure the basic needs of our patients are being met, and that's, you know, it's a team effort, obviously, but nursing is the profession that's there right by the bedside 24/7. So rather than say this person's agitated and restless, we then reach for the medication solution, we need to be then looking at other things: constipation, hydration, hunger, pain. Are they aware of their environment? Are they frightened and fearful? And I always think that some of the literature that I've read around delirium is that people often remember the experience and they talk about it as being a very fearful experience, being controlled by a higher power. And there's some great literature that subscribes to that. So I think, yes, from a nursing perspective, it's around making sure that you know your patient, that you have gone through that little tick sheet in your head that looks at all those basic human needs and comfort that you can provide first. And then being aware that this is a delirium and you have an alert system that says, this person has a high propensity or high possibility of developing a delirium. We're alert to the fact that we need to make sure that all these basic needs are met. I think the other thing is in terms of that late night call that the night nurse calls the young registrar to the ward when things are really, the patient is very disturbed, that the nurse is often very experienced in this and needs to provide some support for their medical colleagues as well. And look at perhaps not jumping to the haloperidol, looking at some other way that we can manage this person non-pharmacologically, and then really provide really good jurisprudence around the medication and the half-life and the peak plasma level, all those pharmacokinetics that, you know, you would expect the nursing staff to talk with their pharmacy colleagues and know about what you're targeting, what's the behaviour, what's the response you need, and working in that team.
And thanks, I really agree with your sentiments around knowing your onset times and your half-life of drugs to optimally, you know, prescribe the right frequency and not repeating the dose before you've had a chance for the first dose to work. The last thing in this space is I've got monitor and review prescribing. So with these new standards, we are going to be encouraged to monitor and review prescribing of psychotropics. And Marie has mentioned at the start, you've done some work in this space. Are you able to share a little bit around what you're doing in monitoring and reviewing antipsychotic use?
Yes, thank you, Mary. So we were able to do an audit of about 17 hospitals throughout Queensland on the use of antipsychotics and benzodiazepines. And the Healthcare Improvement Unit is looking at the possibility of antipsychotic stewardship, following on what antibiotic stewardship has taught us, which is that if you're going to control prescribing and keep society safe, you may want to put up some safeguards on use of the medications, who can prescribe them, how long they're given. So I think many of us are trying to keep the patients safe, but have a live way of getting the medications to them quickly. So it may involve that a dose or two may be given to a patient, but the perpetuation of the medication has to be approved, or there may be some concern for getting a geriatrician evaluation or a pharmacologist or a pharmacist to review the patient before ongoing prescribing of the antipsychotic is given. And then also probably a stop date to say this medication will only be used while in hospital or for a short period of time on discharge. So hopefully we can get into the antipsychotic stewardship area for safe prescribing for our patients.
So moving through to medication administration, as we saw in Joy's case, her delirium, as part of a delirium, she was refusing some of her doses. So having strategies around how to manage these situations is quite important. So Anne, from a nursing perspective, what can you advise on how to handle these situations?
Thanks, Mary. So look, I guess we've probably touched on a whole lot of these principles, but again, it's really knowing your patient. And that's often hard when nurses are working shift work. They may have been out of the ward for 3 days and maybe not know the patient. But it's really important that we know our patient, we know our care plan, and that we've established some sort of cognitive functional baseline. There's lots of really excellent tools now. We should be doing a brief mental test or a 3MS or some sort of very simple but baseline cognitive assessment for our patient. We need to be, the family and the carer and the person need to be part of the treating team. We need to engage them about what's their experience with this person with past medications, their ability to comply with an understanding why they're in hospital, why we're providing some sort of medication. And yes, and Joy became suspicious, and she has this delirium and she doesn't want to take medication. That's not the colour of the tablet that I take at home. I'm not taking it. So we need to be respectful of that and very mindful of that, and try and understand why our patient is they're not actually being particularly difficult. It's their perception and their understanding of being unwell that may elicit that sort of response. So we always must think about that. We can always go back. We try later. We divert their attention. We engage the carer. We offer a cup of tea. And maybe also from a nursing perspective, consider, well, do I really have to give this particular tablet at 4 p.m.? Can I go back at 4:30 or 5 p.m.? So not making the patient feel stuck in a corner and, you know, that we're overbearing. So we need to think about our communication style and provide that supportive care environment. I think the care of the confused, hospitalised older patient provides lots of strategies, lots of resources that look at communication strategies, more education, and providing that supportive care environment and a team effort.
I think the main thing from my point of view is that, you know, pharmacists do have a role in simplifying the medication regime, as you touched on. You know, are we giving medicines unnecessarily? And we also can provide some advice around crushing of medicines if that needs to occur as well. I might move forward to the transitions of care. So ensuring that our patients and healthcare professionals receive all the necessary information on transfer of care is challenging in all settings. But in patients with cognitive impairment, we've got the added layer of complexity around comprehension of complex medication instructions, as well as engaging carers or medication administrators. So it's important that we distribute accurate medicines list, including medication changes and why, to all clinicians, patients, and their carers. The communication should also include instructions for future discontinuation and future review, as not all medicine changes can be made in hospital, and some medicines, such as the antipsychotics, as we've touched on, should be short-term and need clear plans around reducing. So as we saw in the case, a medication list was provided to the patient and carer when they're on their way to TCP. And this was despite the fact that in TCP, the patient wasn't going to be managing their medicines themselves. I often find that we forget to provide information to the patient and the carer when they're not actually going to be managing the medicines themselves. But engaging them is crucial in the patient experience, as well as monitoring for the effects, and particularly side effects. We also need to communicate, look at how we communicate to those with cognitive impairment. So depending on the severity, we may need to adjust our education style. We may need to engage the carers or their family members. And we need to help the consumer often develop systems to help manage their medicines safely in the community, remembering that dose administration aids, such as Webster's, don't solve all medication problems. And after a hospital stay, some patients with cognitive impairment do progress to a residential care facility. And it's important that we also hand over that medication information carefully to ensure appropriate continuity of care. So strategies such as looking at interim medication charts may be useful. And we also shouldn't forget our community pharmacists, as they're often overlooked, but are instrumental in reinforcing messages that may have been forgotten in the counselling process.
Thank you very much, Mary. That was fantastic. And thank you also to Anne-Marie and Anne for your comments as we went through that process. I found that incredibly informative, and I'm sure the participants did as well. So I just wanted to turn it around and provide some tips for our consumers who may be listening in. And here are some quick tips based on those key concepts that we mentioned. And of course, the importance of, because we need to partner with consumers in order to provide safe and high quality care. So consumers can keep an up-to-date list of medicines. They can request, participate in the medicine review. They can request one if they're at home as well. To remember to always ask questions, know your medicines and the risks and benefits, know your rights in decision making about being informed and giving consent. And also when a person's in hospital, for family members and carers, it's always wonderful to help staff get to know the person and also to alert them at any time if a person's not their normal self. And as Mary outlined, being provided with a list of current medicines and reasons for any changes on discharge, and also to consider a review once the person's at home. So, in summary, what went well? And I think you also added some fantastic points in your comments as we went along. But what went well was the husband brought in the medicines. There was a medication review. There was a medication list on transfer. But we could have had an earlier medication reconciliation, an earlier geriatrician consult, as someone else mentioned. We could have had a better choice of medicines and a better choice of the dose. There could have been improved handover to avoid delay. And of course, a lot of you mentioned was the better involvement in family and decision making. So we have listed at the end of the slides a number of resources that you will find useful, the ones for the commission, and also other resources, and they will be available, as I said, on the website, and here they are. So before we finish, I just want to mention that if you have an opportunity to share your experience of safer use of medicines in hospital, if you haven't already, but I'm sure you already have, you've joined the campaign and participating in that. There are more and more hospitals that are sharing what they're doing in their experience, and everyone's finding that really useful. If you tweet, do include us with the hashtag A Better Way to Care. So thank you again for the panelists, and thank you to all our participants. Thank you for all the comments. So on that note, I'll say goodbye to everyone. Thank you.